Well, I'm obsessed with the Twilight Theme Park.
Yeah,
the Twilight Theme Park. You didn't know there was a Twilight Theme Park?
I consider myself a bit of a theme park connoisseur, even though I haven't visited that many theme parks, but I felt like I had a fairly robust knowledge of what was out there, at least in terms of the kind of places that put their theme into a theme park. Think immersive environments, strong placemaking, and indoor storytelling type dark rides, as they're known. So imagine my shock when I found out I'd been blindsided by the existence of a Twilight theme park land that opened as part of Lionsgate Entertainment World in 2019 in China. For context, I could give you my spicy take on the Shanghai Disneyland version of Pirates of the Caribbean, or could tell you about the Universal Studios Beijing Jurassic World ride that I would happily sacrifice my firstborn child to get the chance to ride. So the fact that a Twilight theme park land had opened up in China, and had not only escaped my notice, but no one online was talking about it, blew my mind. So to make up for lost time, I began intensely researching this park, and with every new nugget of information I found as I dug deeper, I became more obsessed. It went so far, I did look into flights to China, but with the state of my current bank account, I decided it was wiser to instead absorb every single scrap of English language information available online about the Twilight theme park land, and a fair bit of the Chinese stuff as well. I even watched all the Twilight movies for the first time, despite having only seen half of the first one, because I wanted to make sure there wasn't any important context I was missing on the Twilight theme park land. And now the baseball scene from Twilight plays on a permanent loop on 4 brain cells wedged at the back of my skull. I didn't, however, read the Twilight books because I can't read. After all my research, I consider myself, excluding those who've worked on the project and maybe some of the people who've actually got to visit for themselves, one of the world's leading experts on the Twilight theme park land, an achievement I am very proud of. And I did all this because I needed to know how, and more importantly, why did a Twilight theme park land come to exist? I think I have the answer now. Part 1, Twilight as a franchise, or why are we surprised? Let's face it, you were surprised when you found out a Twilight theme park land existed. I was also surprised, that's why I've become so obsessed with the fact it does exist. Because the concept seems weird and borderline funny, and it's quite hard to visualize what's actually included in the land if you don't know already. So I just want to pause and analyze for a moment why this concept is so weird and funny, because on paper, from a business perspective, Twilight actually makes a lot of sense to adapt into a theme park land. Since the opening of Disneyland in 1955, the adaptation of popular movies into theme park attractions and experiences has been a core part of the business model. This has become even more of a cornerstone in recent years, with the trend of big, recognizable, beloved film franchises providing the foundation for whole theme park lands, following Universal opening the Wizarding World of Harry Potter in 2010. As much as diehard theme park fans like to whinge about this trend, it actually makes a lot of sense to tie in your new attraction or land into a big movie franchise. It's easy to market to the general public with recognizable characters to attract visitors. You have a built-in fan base that loves these films, who will queue hours just to get in, and spend horrendous amounts of money on exclusive merchandise. And it functions as a design shortcut by already having familiar locations, iconography, and narratives to base your attractions, as well as shops, dining, and other experiences around. Unless you're the team making Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, in which case you create a brand new planet, never before seen in the films, just for the hell of it. Good for you. So if you're purely looking at this from a financial perspective, this feels like an inevitability. Twilight is the 18th biggest film franchise of all time, and almost all of the other top 20 have some level of theme park representation. The only series here that currently have no theme park representation are Mission Impossible, which does have attractions in development at proposed parks in Korea and England, and Lord of the Rings and James Bond, both of which have fairly complicated rights situations involving protective families. So if it makes perfect business sense for Twilight to be in a theme park, why does it still feel weird? You might think the answer is because Twilight sucks and... Well, firstly, I would disagree with you purely on the strength of the baseball scene, but secondly, I don't think that's the answer. The Transformers movies are widely panned, and yet, if you heard about the Universal Studios Transformers ride, and even heard that it was good, I don't think it would be surprising in the way this Twilight thing is. I actually personally think that the Transformers ride is a bit of a hot mess, but that is a different conversation for a different day. So potentially is it that Twilight hasn't stood the test of time in the way that many of these other franchises have? The last Twilight movie came out in 2012, and the theme park land opened in 2019. I do think this is an aspect of it, but also loads of theme park rides are based on slightly outdated materials. Sure, there was an aspect of humor to Disney opening an Avatar theme park 8 years after its cultural moment, but it's still not quite the same. I think the real reason is a little bit more nuanced. There's this idea propagated in theme park discourse a lot, that when you're adapting something into a theme park attraction, you're adapting a story. Largely, I don't think that's the case. Say if you're adapting a book into a film, you might be doing so because of the great narrative or the compelling character arcs, whilst I think it's very different when you're adapting something into a theme park attraction. When you're doing that, at least when it's done successfully, I think instead you're adapting an aspirational element of the text. And yes, I just did use the word text. I have half an English lit degree, fight me on it. You can see this as far back as 1955's Disneyland opening day attraction, Peter Pan's Flight. In the movie's most famous scene, Peter and the gang fly over London to Neverland. In the ride, you also fly over London to Neverland. Bam, great ride. Because in a few short minutes, it captures the aspects of that film you wish you could actually experience. And it's even clearer in contemporary examples. You probably watched Harry Potter and wish you could go to Hogwarts. In the Wizarding World of Harry Potter, you get to go to Hogwarts. Or if you're a Star Wars fan, flying the Millennium Falcon might be a big dream, and that's what you can do at Star Wars Galaxy's Edge. But for Twilight, despite its supernatural elements, it's ultimately a romance. Sure, there are some action sequences, particularly as the series progresses, but it's still a romance at its core. The aspirational aspect of Twilight, the bit that you want to experience that made it such a phenomenon, is having a gorgeous vampire boyfriend. That's the fantasy, and that's much harder to adapt into a theme park experience. Although, maybe there's a gap in the market here. So, with all this being considered, why build a Twilight theme park land? Part 2. Enter Lionsgate. Twilight, despite being so big, wasn't actually made by a major movie studio. Instead, it was made by Summit Entertainment. Summit was founded in 1991 as a movie production company whose notable successes included the American Pie series of films. In 2006, they decided to become a fully fledged mini studio, essentially operating in the way the big dogs like Warner Brothers and Universal do by not only making films, but also distributing and marketing them. It was a risky move, but in 2008, after a string of flops, they finally had their first success. And boy, was it a success.
Good evening. Tonight, Twilight mania has taken over the country.
Screaming, hyperventilating, and downright scary.
This is what it looked like when he arrived at the Mexico airport. Complete mayhem.
So Twilight wasn't just big, it was a cultural phenomenon, so Summit having the rights to Twilight already made other companies interested in buying them. As early as February 2009, so only 3 months after the release of Twilight, Lionsgate, another mini studio, entered talks to acquire Summit. At the time in 2009, Lionsgate would have only been buying a library of 6 films, plus of course the rights to Twilight. So I think it's fair to say the main reason they wanted to buy Summit was for control of Twilight. You might know the name Lionsgate from the Hunger Games series of films, or that trailer for a very interesting version of Pinocchio they released earlier this year.
Father, when can I leave to be on my own? I've got the whole world to see.
These talks fell apart quickly, but 3 years later, in January 2012, Summit Entertainment was bought by Lionsgate for $412.5 million. Now, 3 years later, Summit Entertainment had expanded a lot as a company. They produced a lot more films. They'd even won Best Picture at the Oscars for The Hurt Locker in 2010. So there was a lot more to buying them than Twilight. However, Twilight was still by far their biggest film franchise, although it is notable at this point, only one film in the series, Breaking Dawn Part 2, was left to be released. At the time of the deal, when the CEO of Lionsgate, John Feltheimer, was asked if Twilight would continue on in some form for Lionsgate, he said, "It's hard for me to imagine a movie that does $700 million plus that doesn't have ongoing value. It's an amazing franchise that they've done a great job of maintaining with absolutely no deterioration. So the simple answer is, boy, I hope so." Now, the article this quote featured in spun it as there might be more Twilight films after the fifth one, but note that Feltheimer actually says he expects the franchise to have ongoing value, which is an interesting phrasing. As of 2022, whilst Twilight does seem to be going through a bit of a cultural renaissance recently, which I put partly down to the cycle of nostalgia, but also the former lead's career's going through a real peak recently, in terms of new content, outside of stuff that Stephanie Meyer's doing with the books, there's almost nothing. To date, there is currently no new Twilight films, with the closest to an on-screen continuation being The Storytellers, New Voices of the Twilight Saga, a series of Facebook short films designed to bring more women into film. Whilst a cool project, this isn't exactly the milking of the franchise some might have expected from Lionsgate, especially how in the intervening years, how reboot, sequel-heavy, and IP-dependent Hollywood has become. But IP is still king, and Twilight is still a globally recognized brand that, outside of potential TV and film spin-offs, can be leveraged in terms of merchandising, streaming rights, and of course, theme parks. So by 2015, 3 years after they bought Twilight, and as their equally successful Hunger Games franchise was wrapping up, Lionsgate were reported to be actively looking at ways to leverage their library of films in theme parks. they already had a little bit of representation with some of their horror franchises at Universal Studios Halloween events, as well as saw the ride opening in 2009 at Thorpe Park, a ride I have a lot of opinions about. Notably, Lionsgate weren't looking to actually enter the theme park market in the way that Disney and Universal had. They're more looking for opportunities to license their properties to in-development theme parks, particularly in the rapidly growing markets across Middle East and Asia. At the end of 2016, Motiongate Dubai opened up, a park featuring a variety of IPs from DreamWorks Animation, Columbia Pictures, and yes, our friends at Lionsgate. This park featured two rides based on the Hunger Games and a step-up stage show, with later expansions centering around John Wick and Now You See Me, notably choosing not to include Twilight. Two proposed parks solely focused around Lionsgate properties, one near Atlanta in the States and one in South Korea, were both suspended and as of right now, look unlikely to be built. Though based off the concept art, the South Korean park did seem to have a Twilight Land as part of the proposal. So far, despite Lionsgate's plans for global theme park domination, sadly no Twilight theme park attraction or land had come to be. That all changed in July 2019 when Lionsgate Entertainment World opened on Hengqin Island in China. Part 3. Lionsgate's Entertainment World. So this is how Lionsgate Entertainment World came to exist, a theme park near the gambling and tourism destination of Macau. It was built by a company called the Thinkworld Group, whose most notable work includes a lot of stuff with Warner Brothers properties that isn't the Wizarding World of Harry Potter. The park is part of Novotown, an integrated tourism and entertainment district that is set to include future theme parks such as, I kid you not, a real Madrid world, which will include a flying theater attraction from a soccer ball's point of view, which I don't even know where to begin with that. There's a couple ways that Lionsgate Entertainment World, or at least its marketing, is distinct from other theme parks. For a start, it claims to be the world's first vertical theme park, which is kind of nonsense marketing speak. What it consists of is an indoor mall or shopping center type of environment with a central plaza around which various different Lionsgate movie franchises are situated on different floors, with escalators linking them together. It's quite an odd setup, but I'd say this is probably most similar to what are known in the theme park industries as family entertainment centers, or FECs, smaller indoor theme parks. So rather than being a destination, they typically be aimed at people in the local area, have less attractions than a fully fledged theme park, but also be significantly cheaper to visit. Disney Quest was an attempt by Disney to move into the FEC market, and if you haven't seen Defunct Land's video on this, I highly recommend it. But this is what Lionsgate Entertainment World most closely represents, an indoor, tech-driven theme park. The rides here range from a Gods of Egypt virtual reality coaster to a Divergent virtual reality walkthrough. Look, it doesn't have much variety, with more screens than a Universal park, and as a theme park fan, it's easy to be dismissive of that. However, personally, I think the concept is quite cool, an innovative way of building a park differently for a fraction of the budget of what it would cost to build an equivalent immersive experience otherwise. The downside, of course, is these experiences have to be updated far more frequently to remain competitive. The reason I'm reluctant to describe Lionsgate World as an FEC is due to the F meaning family, as that's clearly not the demographic being targeted here. The LA Times described Lionsgate Entertainment World as the world's first PG-13 theme park. I think it being the first is a bit of a stretch. I can think of a handful of parks clearly aimed at the teenage and young adult crowd, but here in China it is explicitly aimed at the date crowd, which was 16 to 30 year olds who often go out in groups, especially when courting. And what better way to make a park aimed at young adults than centering it around the YA franchises that Lionsgate has the market cornered on? It's like the criteria for being included in this park was having your franchise end in part 1 and part 2 movies, or in the case of Divergent, just part 1. I'd love to talk about the dystopian Hunger Games and Divergent attractions, particularly this weird tension in adapting the luxury of the capital within the Hunger Games into a theme park experience that Suzanne Collins, author of the Hunger Games, specifically praised as smart and sensitive to the themes and concerns of the property, which look, for the sake of not rambling on for another hour, I'm just gonna focus on the Twilight area. Before I get into what entails, you might be wondering how big was Twilight in China? Honestly, this was something I struggled to firmly ascertain within my research, but from having a look at box office figures and book sales, it was definitely a success in China, but nowhere close to the pop culture juggernaut it was in the rest of the world. Part 4, the Twilight Land, or rather floor. I'm now going to go into a bit of an analysis and critique of the Twilight Land slash floor. Now, I'm someone who strongly believes there's only so far you can fully and accurately critique a theme park experience without physically visiting it for yourself, especially with the kinds of technologies used on these attractions. In many ways, me assessing the quality of this experience is similar to talking about a Broadway show you've only watched via dodgy bootleg you've torrented. Sure, you can have an opinion, but it is limited by the fact what you've experienced is a secondhand recording of the art rather than experiencing it firsthand as the artist intended. So basically what I'm saying is, take all my hot takes with a pinch of salt, I could be wrong. So within Lionsgate Entertainment World, each franchise gets a different level within the complex. Twilight's level is themed to Forks, the town in Washington State where most of Twilight is set, and the indoor setting is actually a fairly strong match for the moody, dark-lit town and allows it to keep a permanent nighttime feel. However, due to the structure of the park, there's a slightly surreal shopping center-esque veranda intrusion, which not only breaks the immersion, but also the strong lighting contrasts with the moody feel of the area, though this might be less intrusive when you're actually physically visiting the park. As a themed area, to be honest, there's not a lot going on outside of the headlining attractions, and it lacks some of the staples that movie-based lands typically have, namely themed dining and shops. Though Twilight doesn't necessarily naturally lend itself to these, despite being a perfect opportunity to sell some Twilight water. It does, however, have many photo ops scattered throughout the land between the attractions, most notably Bella's truck, a replica of the Welcome to Forks sign found in the real town, and the gazebo that Edward and Bella dance in at the end of the first Twilight film. This also doubles up as a stage for possibly my favourite part of the Twilight land, the Forks High School Glee Club. So one of the most notable things about Twilight are its soundtracks, and this is brought to life at the park by a quartet of singers who perform a number of iconic numbers from the Twilight films, including Decode by Paramore, It Will Rain by Bruno Mars, and of course A Thousand Years by Christina Perry. I wish they rotated this with a pop-up show recreating the Twilight baseball scene, but hey, you can't have it all. One of my favourite things about theme park movie lands are these random and slightly contrived expansions to the world, and the invention of the Forks High School Glee Club that Bella was definitely too introverted and moody to ever consider joining is the exact sort of canon extension I am delighted to see included. Speaking of canon, one aspect of the land that annoyed some twihards who were following the project closely is that in the facades of the land, there is the Olympic bookstore, which is never mentioned in the books. This may seem like an inoffensive detail if you are a casual follower of Twilight, but it is actually canon that Forks does not have a bookstore, because in the first Twilight, Bella is researching Edward and thinking that he might be some kind of supernatural creature, has to leave Forks to go to Port Angeles in order to find a bookstore, which forms an important part of the narrative of Bella and Edward getting to know each other when he saves her from a scary gang of men. So, points lost there, designers of the Twilight land. So that's the land itself. Whilst not the most immersive of areas, it does seem to do a good job of capturing the personality of Twilight as well as Forks, the town it's set in, with lots of photo ops which the rides don't provide. But ultimately, the quality of a theme park land lives or dies based on the quality of its rides. And here, there are two main attractions. To use a lazy comparison to Disney's Star Wars land, Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, Bella's journey is Rise of the Resistance, a high-tech mixed-media dark ride consisting of a chase sequence through a physical space, supported by a mix of screens, dramatic lighting, and special effects, showcasing action and key iconography from the series. Whilst Midnight Ride is Smuggler's Run, a video game-style attraction in which guests get to control their movements through a digital environment with some unique innovations in theme park technology. And also if Galaxy's Edge had a fraction of the budget. Warning, if you are ever planning on visiting Lionsgate Entertainment World, I'm about to dive deeply into both of these attractions, and there will be major spoilers ahead. Part 5, Midnight Ride. Or the award-winning ride, I might say. It won a THEA, or THEA Award, for Outstanding Achievement in an Attraction. THEA stands for Themed Entertainment Association. Picture the Oscars, if there was only like 15 films released each year. And if they felt like more than one deserved it in the same category, they just gave it to them all anyway. However, I can clearly see why Midnight Ride rather than Bella's Journey was the awards contender out of the two. Because this is the more innovative of the two attractions and has the most potential in terms of influencing future theme park attractions worldwide. Midnight Ride is a virtual reality attraction on which guests take a nighttime motorbike ride through the Forest of Forks. I think the most notable thing before I start talking about this ride is it's basically impossible to do a critical assessment of how good this ride is without riding it myself. There's often a trend of media-based attractions looking comparatively worse when viewed via POV video on YouTube than roller coasters or more traditional dark rides. In the case of VR, you can't even film it with a camera, so I can't base my assessment off a POV recording of this ride. Instead, all the footage of the ride I've seen comes from official materials released both by the park and the companies who worked on this ride. This ride is clearly inspired by the second Twilight film, New Moon, in which, struggling with depression after Edward leaves her, Bella becomes obsessed with motorcycles, which builds her relationship with hunky wolf next door, Jacob Black. It makes sense to use motorcycles as a ride vehicle on a Twilight ride. It's a rare point where the action is not just a side aspect of the story, but a central thrust of the core romantic narrative. Bella becomes an adrenaline junkie, specifically as a coping mechanism, to deal with her heartbreak when Edward leaves her at the start of the film. Basing her ride around the motorcycle adrenaline seems like a perfect opportunity to connect a theme park thrill to the emotional, romantic heart of Twilight. So instead in the ride, guests are tasked by Jacob with a mission of riding out with the wolf pack to help put a stop to the volatile and unpredictable vampire newborns prowling the forest, as seen in the third Twilight movie Eclipse. And that's really as far as it goes in terms of story with this ride. It's a shame that the ride takes a more generic approach, with the motorbikes in this ride not even vaguely linked to Bella's obsession depression with motorbikes in New Moon, or even the character of Bella at all. Despite it not being the most involved story for a theme park ride, what I do love is on this behind the scenes video, with a little over 4,000 views and just one comment, Ian Gregg asks, are the events of this ride canon to the Twilight Saga movie series? Which is a very interesting question. But I think less of a concern on this plot-light, more experience-driven attraction. In the attraction, riders sit on motorcycles and don VR headsets. Each bike is steerable by the rider, allowing them to drive down their own path within the forest and see the other riders around them, with each bike designed to be uniquely identifiable. The ride even uses hand tracking technology, so if you lift your hands away from the handlebars of the bike, your hands in VR will do so as well, adding to the immersion of this experience. Each bike sits on a motion base, which syncs with the movements happening in VR, and alongside pine scents, binaural audio, wind effects, and even seat rumblers, engages as many senses to make this as immersive as possible. So VR. I'm not a VR hater. Fun fact, I was actually part of a group project that made a VR game in college. My main issue with VR in terms of its implementation in theme parks is often little thought seems to be put into why the system is being used. There was a trend a few years ago, which thankfully seems to have died out, of adding VR to pre-existing roller coasters. Based on my experience of these, it seemed to defeat the purpose of what made a roller coaster so special, a big part of which is moving through that tangible, physical environment. Instead, the main achievement seemed to be slowing down capacity with clunky, expensive equipment that takes too long to set up well, overlaying an inconsistent virtual experience over a perfectly good real one. For Midnight Ride, rather than VR being tacked onto a pre-existing physical ride, everything is being built around the virtual reality here. So that means every physical element is trying to enhance the virtual reality rather than the virtual reality trying to enhance the physical experience. The graphics in the clip's release may not seem that impressive, but one thing to remember is that this is a fully interactive experience rendered in real time in which each guest gets to choose the direction they go independent of the other guests and also still see them within the same world. I've seen complaints online that Disney's newer Millennium Falcon ride has worse graphics than their old Star Wars ride, Star Tours. And this is why. One is a movie-style pre-rendered CGI image, and the other is an interactive, rendered in real-time graphic that is more comparable to a video game, just like on Midnight Ride. So Midnight Ride, we should be comparing the quality of the graphics less to a movie and more to a video game. Even still, I imagine this must look better in action.
I'm off to the leaky cauldron for a few butterbeers.
Still, virtual reality is a relatively big industry outside of just being a tool within the theme park space. And with how obsessed Mark Zuckerberg is becoming with the metaverse, it feels like this is inevitably only going to become bigger over the next few years. At first glance, this combination of relatively high-end VR with the more traditional theme park tools of wind, motion, and scent, whilst making it a relatively unique VR experience, doesn't particularly seem to be one that's notable enough on a global scale to be, as I mentioned earlier, award-winning. So what was it that made Thea want to acknowledge Midnight Ride with an award for outstanding achievement in a theme park attraction? Well, in their own words, Twilight Saga Midnight Ride is unique in being a multi-rider, high-capacity, interactive virtual reality experience to open as a major theme park attraction. The VR headset system facilitates a quick and efficient ride load and unload, while at the same time providing for a simple and effective cleaning system. So a major aspect of the innovation here wasn't the VR itself, but it being executed in a way that allowed it to be high enough capacity to be a theme park attraction. As I mentioned before, one of my issues with how VR has been implemented in theme park attractions is how slow it is to set up. If you've ever done VR, I'm sure you remember a fair few teething issues putting on the headset, adjusting the straps, making sure it's in focus, getting to grips with the controls, and so on. Midnight Ride streamlines many of these issues by making riders, before they enter the room, put on these very sexy and comfortable looking plastic frames over their heads. Riders then mount the motorcycles, and the VR hardware lowers from the ceiling, connecting to the plastic frame with a magnetic clamp. After the ride is finished, the headsets are also automatically cleaned, saving time for ride operators not having to go around with a pack of wet wipes like in other theme park VR rides. You might think as a theme park guest that this isn't very exciting and is much more exciting if you're a theme park operator, but ultimately, high capacity attractions mean shorter queue lines. And so far, virtual reality has never been added to a theme park in a way that could be a major new attraction, and in many ways, Midnight Ride is paving the way forward for that to be a possibility. I'm still skeptical about whether this is scalable up to a Universal or Disney-sized crowd. Ultimately, however quickly you move people through, each guest still needs an individual headset, compared to a more traditional simulator ride such as Soarin' or The Simpsons ride, where you have hundreds of people watching the same screen. However, Universal is rumored to be adding a Harry Potter virtual reality flying broomstick attraction to their parks in the near future, and if they found a way to execute it that can meet guest demand, I can imagine many of the innovations used here are going to be implemented and built on to make that possible. So my overall thoughts on this ride is, it looks pretty good. But how good would depend on, in practice, how much the sum of its parts work together to create a truly immersive and interactive experience. My feeling is, if it's good enough for Thea, it's good enough for me. Still, despite its awards and acclaim, I think functionally within the land, it operates very much as a side dish attraction, with the main course being. Part 6, Bella's Journey. Before I get into this ride, I want to briefly talk about one of the Disneyland opening day attractions, Snow White and Her Adventures. With the princess's name in the title of the attraction, some guests left it confused why she didn't appear at all in the attraction. The idea was the experience was a first-person ride. Instead of watching the story unfold as a third-person spectator, the audience saw the events of the classic tale through Snow White's perspective. If you went on the ride, you were Snow White. This concept unfortunately went over a lot of people's heads, and so a singular Snow White figure got added to the opening scene, with the rest of the ride remaining intact. Later incarnations of the attraction ditched this concept entirely, which is a shame as it's an interesting perspective for a ride to take, for the rider to literally take the viewpoint of the protagonist in the story. So Bella's Journey will feel somewhat familiar if you've had the chance to ride Universal's Transformers or Spider-Man rides. You board a similar kind of vehicle that moves along a track but tilts and pivots in a way a simulator does, traveling past a mix of physical environments and screens featuring CGI versions of recognizable characters. The main difference between those rides and this one is this one's not in 3D and doesn't require 3D glasses to ride, and also, amusingly, the ride vehicle is themed after Bella's iconic orange Chevy truck from the films. I initially really struggled to find information on this attraction, but by finding out the name of the attraction in Chinese and then searching for it on Chinese social media platform Bilibili, I did find one video. The quality of it isn't the best, but it gives you a gist of what happens in the ride. I then went on to Fiverr, I paid someone to translate it from Mandarin into English, and I have a rough translation of what takes place. There are gaps in the translation, partly because of the bad audio quality, but also because I think the poor woman who's translating it had never seen a Twilight film, so had no context. So with that being said, here's a quick run through of the ride and what happens. The ride begins with us entering the forest, pine scents being pumped in. We encounter Alice, who warns us to be careful, and something about a dangerous secret that cannot be revealed. The next scene we see Edward, standing in sunlight and sparkling, revealing who he is to us. This is followed by a scene running through the forest and up a tree, presumably on Edward's back, and the ride takes a moment to pause and admire the view of the forest below. We can then hear Jacob apologizing for a mistake he's made, before lightning and thunder strike and the Volturi appear in front of us. Jacob, Edward and Alice appear, and Edward tells Jacob they need to go to higher ground. He then directly looks at us, the rider, and says, "Bella, I will always be by your side to protect you." Unfortunately, we immediately run into the Volturi, and Arrow, the leader of the Volturi, threatens us because mortals are not meant to know about the existence of vampires. One of the Volturi leaps towards us, but Edward fights him off, and what follows is an action chase sequence down the side of a mountain. However, Alice comes to the rescue, and in classic Twilight fashion, shows the Volturi a vision, which makes them retreat. So this ride is pretty confusing, but there's a few interesting things happening here. Firstly, the ride is told from Bella's perspective. Going back to Snow White and her adventures, this ride takes a unique decision to make us Bella Swan, just like the original version of that ride did for Snow White. Reminiscent of the Twilight books, this means we only see the world and the story through her direct perspective. It's interesting because one common feminist critique of both Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs and Twilight is how passive their female leads are within their own stories. Their agency is limited, and at many points in the story, things are happening to them or around them rather than being driven by them. For a theme park ride adaption, it's actually a bit of a blessing in disguise, because with the exception of some interactive rides, the viewpoint that we see the events of a ride through is typically fairly passive. Imagine being on a Spider-Man ride as Spider-Man and feeling like a passive part of his own story. It would feel quite strange, which is why both Universal and Disney's Spider-Man rides have us be an ally of Spider-Man rather than Spider-Man himself. So I think it's really cool that we see this ride entirely from Bella's perspective. Well, almost entirely, because at the end of the ride, there's one final scene where we go past Edward and Bella kissing in the forest. I don't know if this is similar to the Snow White situation where they thought guests going on a ride called Bella's Journey and not seeing Bella once might be confusing, or instead it was a desire to depict this key image of Twilight Bella and Edward actually kissing, and realizing there's no way of doing it from a first-person perspective that isn't deeply uncomfortable. Honestly, I thought the decision to choose Bella's viewpoint as the perspective of this ride was a really bold one, and I'm disappointed to see them drop the ball at the last hurdle, or whatever the sports metaphor is. So I guess what happens now in the ride is we see it through Bella's perspective until the final scene, where we switch to someone else's perspective, and I'm gonna pretend it's Jacob's purely for the drama. Now, let's get into the story of this ride. So normally theme park dark rides, which are based off an IP, do one of two things. A, adapt a version of the story from the IP, or B, create an original story based in the world of the IP. And this ride is doing both, neither? Honestly, it's hard to tell. Officially, according to the designers of the ride, this is retelling the events of the Twilight Saga. And that's what we see. Key iconic scenes ranging from Edward revealing himself sparkling under the sun in the first Twilight, to the fight against the Volturi in Breaking Dawn Part 2. But rather than feeling like different scenes from the Twilight Saga presented separately from each other, here they feel like they're strung together in a new narrative, a kind of mashup of the greatest hits of Twilight into one sort of new story. Let's look at the Volturi's presentation here. In New Moon, due to a series of events, Edward, Alice, and Bella end up in Italy and meet the Volturi for the first time face to face. And because mortals aren't meant to know about vampires, they say Bella must die. Alice manages to save the day by showing Arrow a vision of Bella becoming a vampire in the future. In Breaking Dawn Part 2, Edward and Bella have a creepy human vampire baby hybrid, and the Volturi see this as a danger, and so go to Forks to destroy the Cullens. When they arrive, once again Alice manages to save the day by showing Arrow a vision, where an enormous fight breaks out between the Volturi and the Cullens, ending in his death. In the ride, what appears to be happening is kind of a hybrid between the New Moon and Breaking Dawn Part 2 encounters with Volturi. The Volturi want to kill Bella because she knows about the vampires, a fight breaks out in Forks between the Cullens and the Volturi, and Alice saves the day by showing a vision. However, one key thing to know is that infamously, the big fight at the end of Breaking Dawn Part 2 doesn't actually happen. It's a fake out that takes place within Alice's vision.
What the?
So does the fight sequence against the Volturi, which takes up most of the second half of this ride, actually happen? Based on the way it's displayed, the implication here is this actually does happen. There's no visual transition or suggestion that implies this is all happening within Alice's vision, which means this is the only piece of Twilight media in which the stalemate between the Volturi and the Cullens actually leads to violence, with the exception of a minor skirmish between Edward and Felix, one of the Volturi, in New Moon. So what is Alice showing Arrow in her vision? Is it like in New Moon, a vision of Bella becoming a vampire further down the road? Or is it like in Breaking Dawn Part 2, a vision of this little skirmish escalating in a way that leads to his demise? Honestly, it could be either, and I don't think the ride particularly cares, or at least expects us to care. But I care, and I know someone else who would care. My friend Ian Gregg in the Midnight Ride comment section, he would care. Ian, you were asking this question about the wrong ride. So, let's answer the question. Are the events of Bella's journey canon to the Twilight movie series? I think the ride establishes its own canon. Here, the events that take place in the attraction are presented in a very different way to the movies, trimming the cast down to just a few key players and stripping away convoluted lore. This makes sense when you want to make a ride that is accessible to those who haven't seen the Twilight movies, which is a fairly high percentage of those who are going to ride. What doesn't seem to work is this attempt to have their cake and eat it too. It wants to have all the iconic moments of the Twilight Saga for fans, but also wants to be a standalone cohesive experience for people who've never watched it. The end result is something that is confusing and nonsensical for diehard fans of the franchise. Ultimately, I think it's fair to say that most people, with the exception of myself and Ian, actually don't care about this stuff. And overall, it looks like a good, well put together ride. However, I do think the second half of the ride, once the Volturi come in, it feels like very familiar modern screen-based ride content. It's probably a real blast when you're riding, having ice-cold winds blown at you and being spun from screen to screen, but to me, feels fairly generic. However, I remember earlier talking about the idea of Twilight being a theme park ride feeling weird and funny because it's ultimately a romance, and so I do want to highlight how the first half of this ride comes really close to recreating that emotional, aspirational aspect of the text. We see Edward in the forest glistening in the sunlight, and then transition to a scene where we ride on his back, climbing up a tree and looking down at the forest and mountains in the distance. The music swells, it feels romantic, and it's an interesting attempt to try and map the physical thrills of a theme park ride onto the emotional romantic thrills that Twilight excels best at. In the film, this scene became a bit of a meme due to the goofy way that Edward's pals were depicted, detracting from what should be a thrilling romantic scene.
You better hold on tight, spider monkey.
In the ride, by removing the image of Edward and depicting the scene in a bit more of an abstract way, it creates something that achieves a stronger response. This comes the closest to what I think a Twilight theme park ride should be, and honestly it's a shame it's such a small section of the ride. because I think if this ride had the confidence to move away from the theme park cliche of the antagonist that's out to get you and the chase sequence, there was something in here that did something different for the underappreciated art form that is the theme park ride. Something that was willing to stir up nuanced emotions and harness the transformative power of that all-encompassing immersive medium to create something that made people feel fundamentally different than before they rode it. Or maybe Twilight just doesn't adapt well to a theme park setting, I don't know. Anyway, I need a refill. Do you want to get a drink?